Hey guys, welcome to my channel. And I know that last week when I made a video about PhD programs and what you should do, how you should build your profile to get into those PhD programs, you guys asked me to make a video particularly on the SOP drafting. Okay, and in this video, I'm gonna make sure that you can make the absolute best draft for your profile. Now, straight off, I'm gonna tell you first thing is that this video is inspired by someone who I actually really, really follow. And you know, there was this person who we worked with also, and she had a great profile. And we worked with her, and the result was that she got into Stanford, she got into MIT, she got into Columbia, all three of these top schools. And I think that, you know, she was originally from the US itself. So maybe that was something that was held in her favor, and she got an edge because of that. But I think that it's still a very good thing to understand really what her draft looked like and how we actually really focus on some points. And I think that if you just take a look at that, I think this is a lot more of a conceptual sort of an issue. And if you just take a look at that, it'll just make your own drafts 100 times better. I'm sure that by the end of this video, you will have at least some ideas in your head. Okay, so if that's something that you're interested in, and by the way, you will also get a chance to see some of those drafts. So if that's something that interests you, you want to take a look at, stick around and we'll get to that very, very soon in the video. Hey guys, the first thing I want to show you is this diagram over here. Take a look at this diagram and understand how special this is, okay? This simple diagram actually has the basically caliber to turn your draft into something that can be 10 times better than it already is. I'm not sure if you already have something like this in your draft, but again, I'm gonna talk about this because some people might not, okay? The one thing that I notice in these drafts that really do well in the PhD programs is that they should have extreme clarity, okay? They should be extremely lucid, extremely clear, like what is going on should be evident, and it should be like a story, it should not be boring, okay? So the first thing over here is that whenever you start your draft, you should start with a fact, or maybe you should start with a problem that you are facing. And this should be a research problem. It should not be a small problem that's already been solved by someone else in the world. It should be basically a problem that everyone is facing. Okay, literally everyone faces this problem, but they will need a solution to that. And you know, people are working on a solution. Maybe that can be true. Maybe a lot of people are working on a solution for it, but they're not able to come up with the standardized solution. You know, like you have a very standardized solution for a lot of things in your field itself, if you think about it. I mean, depending on your field, you can think about some things that have a very standardized solution, like this is the way to do this. Well, there may not be some of these things. For instance, in computer science, you may not have a very defined way to actually deal with big data. Like, data can be extremely, extremely big. Like, there's not just petabytes of data, there are actually bigger, you know, ways to measure it as well. And just by having that daunting amount of data, it's actually such a problem dealing with it, because it can take hours to days for computers, with even with today's high technology, to actually process all the big data. Okay, so that can be just one example for it, but there's just so many of them out there. Okay, eventually, if you take a look at this diagram, you can see that your research problem should basically be fixed by the PhD. If you actually do this PhD, you want to show the university that if I actually am selected for this PhD program and I do it at your university, the end goal is that I will be able to solve this problem, or at least get closer to what would be called a solution in some sense, right? So yeah, that's one thing that you should remember. I think this is the best summary of this video there can be. There are going to be other points, of course. I'm gonna really, you know, talk you through them one by one, but what I want you to understand is this is really the whole story. This is really the whole concept. Do not let the admissions committee get bored. Make it like a story, create a good flow, and make sure that you define the problem that you are working towards. Okay, the research problem, PhD, and your end goal. Now, there's a couple more things that this diagram entails, and I'm going to talk to you about those now. First thing, what are the approaches that you have taken already to solve this? Okay, this is extremely important. You cannot just show the committee that, you know, I have this problem in my mind that I would like to solve, but I've never even worked on it. No, that's not gonna work. unfortunately, you need to show that, all right, I've taken these steps, maybe I tried it this way and then I tried it this way, but eventually what happened was I was getting it basically a lot of issues over here, like issues like A, B, C and X, Y, Z over here. So something like that, it just shows them that you are actually trying to get to a solution already, and the PhD degree would just help you get there. It won't make you get there, right? I just want to repeat that. It's really important. The PhD will help you get there and not make you get there. It's not something that's going to force you. It's going to facilitate that, okay? Great. So first thing, you want to talk about the approaches you've taken. You want to talk about the papers that you have read, research papers that have been written by other researchers. Maybe you found some of them very, very powerful in solving that problem that you were facing. Maybe someone already has a pretty good solution, but it's still not 100% what you wanted, right? So you can actually show that. That will give you a lot of bonus points, right? And then there's other things like, you know, what kind of research you did, what kind of projects you pursued in the pursuance of this problem, who you worked with. Maybe you worked with your professors, maybe you worked with your mentors. How many papers did you do with them on this topic, okay? Did you present some? What happened? Like, you know, all of these things, if you can just give them the gist of the story, like I said, make it like a story and give it to them, hand it to them on a platter, they will enjoy it. Remember, they have a lot of SOPs to read that day. There's a lot of files in front of them and you're just another file, but you want to be more than a file in front of them, and your SOP can help you do that. Whenever they are reading your SOP, remember, they should not be thinking that the last one we read was actually pretty interesting and this one is just boring me, remember? So if something like that is going on in their minds, that's a very bad sign. You want to stop there and you want to make sure that your SOP is the one that they are thinking about even when they are reading the next applicant's SOP, right? So I hope that this helps you understand what I'm really talking about. It should be engaging. It should not be boring at any point. I'm sure you already knew that. Anyway, so let's actually talk about a few more things. But before that, I just want to tell you that in your SOP, you know, do not elongate it a lot. You know, do not elongate it unnecessarily, but give a lot of examples. Give a lot of examples as in maybe you've done a lot of projects to work towards the solution to your research problem, right? So you can talk about all of those projects, every single one of them, and how it helped you reach towards a solution, maybe even 10% if you have. But you have to justify that. You have to show that you've been working in that field. Okay, maybe you've been working with professors from not just your university, but other universities as well. That will also get you some bonus points. So give a lot of examples wherever you can, but whenever you feel like you're just elongating it, but there's no actual genuine information being added to the draft, I would advise you to stop and keep it short, okay? Anyway, I'm gonna give you some more points over here. I actually did a video for SOPs on graduate school, basically master's applicants last year, but I think it's still applicable very, very well. I'm gonna give you all these points in a written down manner so that you can actually use them. So if you go onto these articles over here on ymgrad.com, you can just go onto the articles page and scroll down to the bottom. Over here, you can see how to write a winning statement of purpose. I'm just gonna walk you through these points because I think they're extremely important. The first thing over here is writing anecdotes, okay? Do not write statements, write anecdotes. Basically, give them short stories and prove it to them. Basically, don't just claim something that, you know, I'm really interested in that. Prove it to them by showing them that, all right, I did this, I tried this, and that just basically shows that you're interested in something, you know? So that's something that you should be very, very, you know, careful about. This will help you create that flow such that they will not forget your draft, okay? One more thing, conciseness. I already talked about that. It's highly valued. They read probably hundreds of drafts every single day. You want to keep it short, you want to keep it to the point, and you want to keep it goal oriented, okay? At the end, you just want to get into the university, okay? Then don't use words that you cannot justify. If you're using a word like, basically some people write like this, you know, I've been passionate about computer science ever since I was 5. What were you doing when you were 5? Were you, I don't know, were you you know, on your laptop all day or building programs or something? Because that's something that you need to justify now. Understand this, you know, since you were 5, how does that justify, right? So you need to think about things before you write them. That's one more thing that I wanted to point out. Again, then one more thing over here is that you should always customize your SOP draft. A lot of people just don't customize it. What they usually do is they submit the same SOP to 5 or 6 universities. that will not bode well with them. You want to tell them why you have picked their program, why their university, okay? And one of the best reasons for this, especially for PhD programs, are professors. You should definitely get in touch with some professors, talk to them about their research that interests you, talk to them about the research that you have done. If there is an alignment, especially, chances are you're gonna get into the university. And one of the biggest reasons can be that the professor is just as interested in working with you as you are in working with him, okay? And you can actually get to that stage, understand that. It's possible, it's very much possible, okay? Next is help them know you better. Like I said, do not just write statements, talk about yourself, help them get to know you, because no other part of your application basically lets the admissions committee know who you are as a person. And I think the SOP can actually do that for you, okay? Great. These questions that you cannot afford to skip, these are extremely important questions. Remember, I'm gonna leave the link to this article in the description so you can always go on and check it out. But these questions, I think they are extremely important. So just, you know, take a look at them. How can your background, skills, and experience add value to your class? One thing to do over here would be to show that you have a diverse background as compared to what your class might have. So maybe you've just not studied mathematics, but you also know biology, you know? So something like that would actually show that you can basically take a look at things from a different perspective, maybe an interdisciplinary perspective, and that gets you bonus points, okay? Where do you see yourself after the completion of your degree? Again, very important question. Like I said, your end goal should be defined in the first or second paragraph itself, that this is the research problem that I'm willing to solve. And still, after you solve that, maybe, if, you know, what if you solve that? Do you want to become a professor? Do you want to go into the industry, work in R&D? Anything like that, you should definitely consider mentioning it. I think without it, it's still incomplete. One more thing, how will the program help you achieve your goals? As I said, the PhD program should help you achieve your goals. That's, again, in the beginning itself, you should definitely consider mentioning that. It's an extremely important point. The SOP is incomplete without it. And then finally, the extremely, you know, important part over here, I think you already know that, is that make sure that you read it 3, 4, 5, 10 times if you need to, but make sure that there are no grammatical errors. One good way would be to go ahead and check it on Grammarly, or show it to some friends who are really good at English, or, you know, whatever it is, you just need to make sure that your draft does not have those issues that just puts the committee off. And they would basically not want someone who cannot even, you know, write a draft well. So make sure that that's something that does not come up in your application at all, okay? We actually have another one on this channel itself, like another video, 10 tips to writing a statement of purpose. Some of the tips might overlap because these are just tips for the graduate school applicants, but I would recommend watching this. And one more thing over here, like I said, you can actually get the SOP that we were talking about, you know, the SOPs of these PhD applicants that, yeah, you can get it. But one thing over here, not everyone will do this. I know only about 10 to 15% of the people who are watching this would actually go about it, but those 10 to 15 people will actually have an edge, okay? Understand that. Okay, I would suggest go onto this article, click on the sign up button over here, and you will actually get the free draft of the person who was admitted into Stanford University. There's actually a couple more drafts in there of people who were admitted to various top class universities, and we're giving it to you for free. All you have to do is just go ahead and sign up. I know only, like I said, 10 to 15% will do it, but if you do it, you will have an edge. That's just it. Let me actually tell you when you will get it. Once you sign up and you actually go onto your dashboard, basically once you log in, that's when you, for the first time when you log in, you will get an email with the free study material and everything, and it will also have a link which will have, you know, basically free study material. With that, you will also have free SOPs and free LORs and everything you need, basically. Okay, I just wanted to make sure that you find it, because a lot of people at times they message me, they tell me I couldn't find it. So yeah, that's how you find it. Okay, I hope this video makes sense. It helps you out. If you have any questions, I would recommend posting them down below, or reaching out to me, or basically just posting it on YMGrad. You can also reach out to me on Instagram, by the way. Okay, I hope this video helps. Again, it was a quick video on PhD, basically SOPs. If you want some more videos on PhD, or maybe, you know, some similar topic, what you can do is you can just let me know, comment down below, or reach out to me on Instagram about that as well. And I'll be happy to make it for you. Again, subscribe to the channel if this helps you, and I'll see you in the next one.